a sacrifice of praise. Oh Jesus, to offer up, oh God, these songs, these words, to confess these words of faith, Jesus. We want to thank you, God, for what we have been hearing from this pulpit, Jesus. We want to thank you, God, that there is life in your word. And we want to thank you, Jesus, that it's only your word that can satisfy us. It's only you, Jesus, that can fulfill us. That we are complete in you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, God.
There's nothing in are enough for us, Lord. You are our one and not sufficient for us, Jesus. You are a provider. You is everything. You are our deliverer, our redeemer, our savior. In you we have peace and forgiveness. In you we have a new beginning. In you we are prosperous and emotionally and physically and Lord spiritually. Everything. We have joy today that passes all understanding and peace that passes all understanding. Have your spirit, Lord, we thank you. We are more than conquerors through you. We can achieve all things through you today. Lord, today we come and we declare in faith that you are our provider of provision, our all in all. In you we live and move and have our being today. We say glory be to God today. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Desire you to be.
By his blood.
Relationships, career, or finance. Now, I was on the verge of a 5.5 year struggle trying to work out finances, trying to work out my career, usually between 22 to say 30. These are usual challenges, right? How to work out a career, how to work out finances, will I grow in career or not, how are my relationships, who will I marry, the same usual questions. But not getting an answer, I reached a stage where I was on the verge of complete depression. Okay, let me tell you, that time I was not saved. All I knew is, how would I just reach the next appraisal? Will I get an appraisal in a corporate? Will I ever earn money? Will I be able to give things to my parents, as usual all youngsters think? And that 5.5 year struggle made me seek the Lord. God, where are you? Am I meant for something? Will I do something different, or am I supposed to sit here depressed? Just remember, I reached a level of depression where all I wanted to do is die one day. But then I thought, let me give it one try before I die. Let me find where God is on this earth. Does God stay here or somewhere else? He doesn't see my problems. That's when I started seeking. And it went on a struggle of 2.5 years. I just kept on seeking where God is. I went to 26 different shrines. 19 of them were churches from Andheri East itself, because you know I was into business development, I couldn't afford going to other cities to search where God is. And I learned from my parents, God is everywhere. I said, okay, let me go and search God. And after going to all the shrines, I went to Gurudwaras and I went to Haji Ali also, for your information. And my quest is still on, okay, should I die? No, let me search God first. He should definitely answer me before I die. If there is no answer, I'll move on, it's okay. After seeking, I came to a verge in office, I would sit and Google, okay, ways to die quicker. And again, nothing would come out of it. This is not working out. And in the meantime, remember this 2.5 years, I'm going to different churches, going different places. Nobody would welcome me. Nobody would answer me, what's Bible? How do I live my life? And after the 26th church, I sat on my bed. I said, this is not working out, God. What is the final work? What do I need to do? You never talk to me. And what happened is, so it was the last flyer on my bed I picked. Okay, this is the red one. Let me visit this one and come. If this works out, nothing like it, else I know what to do. That day, on a Wednesday, I entered Amboli Church first time. I asked, where is the pastor? I need to see pastor. You know, I don't talk to everyone else. Neelam was very sweet. She looked at me. But you know, there is Pastor Devendra. He has a service today. Why don't you just attend it? I said, but when will I meet pastor and his wife? Okay, they will come back from US by Jan end, they said. Okay, I'm understanding. Okay, let me check it. They said, I said, okay, I'll wait, Neelam. And it was Devendra, our Pastor Devendra, who was taking the service that day. I just sat through, numb, you know, as in depression, you do not know what's going on around you. I was quiet. I suddenly had something moving within me I could feel. I came out. I told myself, I think we can pen dying for 7 days. It's okay to give it one more chance. Something moved when Devendra was there. Something he spoke there. I vanished from the church for 2 weeks. I don't know what was happening. I came back. It was Kishore, Pastor Kishore that day. He never judged me when I came back. He said, oh, wonderful to see you in church. So you're coming from Sunday churches also? I said, okay. Why I shared is that whenever I went to the other churches earlier, they always judged me that if you do not come to church on a Sunday, you're not a good person. You know, coming from an unsaved background, a Hindu background, it was a big thing for me for not getting judged in a church for not coming on a Sunday. And what I was learning for is, please ask me why did I not come on a Sunday? Why do I not come to church daily? It was because a boss was bothering me to work all day. He didn't allow me to reach the church. And the very next, after a few days, cut to 15 days, I had Pastor Karl's classes going on. I said, okay, let me take the Bible college. That's all I was learning for all these days. Pastor Karl was covering how a quiver and an arrow is created, hardened, and then it is sent to different parts of the world, and this is how God uses you. I was, hooray! I found God uses us, and that is what I wanted, to give some utility to this world. And I found a reason. I said, now I'm not giving up. Now no more dying. Now I need to go back and do my church classes. Then I took up my call, and after that there was no looking back. Then Sue was sweet. I did not know who she was that time, right? She ensured, she said, Vipi, all I want you to do is seek the Lord. Develop your relationship with Jesus first. She did not know, okay, that I was planning to kill myself and all those funny plans. I laugh at that now. So all she did is she told me, seek the Lord and develop your relationship. So I thought, let me give it some time. Let me develop my relationship, my personal relationship with Jesus. And it is now after that, there was no turning back, like right now you all sang. There was just no turning back after that. The same concerns I said a youngster has, personal relationships. I have emotional stability. I got it within the initial 1 month itself. I could see God's love for me. There was no looking back. Finances, let me give you an example. I was a girl who was earning hardly 28,000 that time. But then from there, God rose me to a business development manager. From a manager, I rose to a business leader directly, okay? Many of you in corporate, so it's not that easy. To a business leader, to a vice president, to a president. And I was like, God, He actually gives exceedingly abundantly beyond expectations for any agenda you can think of in life. That's what I said. Career should be maybe a VP in a corporate should be more than enough. And the day I remember, the Pastor Karl's class, remember, I just quoted, God uses us like an arrow to be in different parts of the world. I do not know what am I meant for. I give it time, right? I give it that God, in your time, I wait upon to see where are you using me. And then I was happy being a president, but see God. I was there right behind in the church there that day when He gave me a Jeremiah 29:11. And today, I'm an entrepreneur. So just see, I started my career as a BA teacher teaching 10th and 12th standard. Today, I'm an entrepreneur. When God gave me the business, I was minus 35 rupees in my bank account. I told Sue one day, I was minus 35 rupees in my bank account. But He said, I believed. God has said it will happen. Even if I'm minus 35 rupees, it's okay. Because He has said it will happen. I could trust Him. from minus 35 rupees, within 3 months, the business was in break even. Those who are business owners who know that it is not easy to break even a business in the very third month. It was the third month because that is the payment cycle a client first pays you. So I could not help it. The first payment came in. So I started from minus 35 rupees. It came into a break-even business. And now I work with the 3-comma club. I hope you understand. They're all billionaires. This is the trust we carry because of Jesus. Otherwise, if you go and ask the world, ask them a startup that works with the 3-comma club. You will not really find one. That too, I was never from a business background. Right? I just wanted to be a simple VP in a corporate. That's what it did. So whether it is career or designation or it is money or it is relationships, stability you're looking at, Jesus is the answer for all. Amen. And those who do not know Jesus here, I would just say, being unsaved, the biggest realization I had in life is there is one miracle book called the Holy Bible. Wow. Just get up and read it. It has answers to every question you have in your life. You don't need anybody. Just pick up and ask, God, I need you to answer me today. This is my agenda. This is my problem. I don't want to discuss with anyone. You answer me and the Bible will answer you for it. And that's what I was seeking the 2.5 years going around the churches, right? Someone to answer me my all questions that I have as a child. My career, my finance, my marriage, whom will I go ahead with, and then what is my next steps in life? I was never confused after that. The youngsters out of this church, I can guarantee you, live in confusion. I was never confused. But I want to bring it to a notice that there were certain decisions that made me see these reversals happen from a negative bank balance to a 3-comma club, from a manager to an entrepreneur, being your own business CEO. There was one reason for it. The emotional stability, there was a reason for it. The decisions that made a difference to my life, first is, I learned to put God first in my life. I was never attached to the world after that. I knew my attachment is only Jesus. For everything I would tell my office, I need to talk to Jesus before I come back to you, and they would laugh at me. It never made any difference to me. Because when they saw the results, they were like, my man is doing the right thing by going to Jesus. Putting God first is the most beautiful decision you can take in your life. His love will cover it all, believe me. Second thing, I call it the power of association in business. Power of association is, you cannot seek guidance from the world when you have Jesus and the Bible with you. So I ensured my guidance were my pastors. I went to my pastor whenever I needed guidance for the business also. They gave me wonderful books that worked for me. I ensured I'm there at the ladies' time. And I told God, you will speak to me through Sue today, okay? And God did that every single time. Then after Bible college, I ensured I'm there in Bible college after ladies' time. Because I worked like 12 hours a day. It was difficult for me to manage. But I managed. I took a step of faith. Said, God, you need to keep me around these people, else I'm not going to grow the business, I know that. Because that was my calling. Remember I told you I was 5 years career struggling, trying to know my calling? I found it. A big decision in life you can take is being around the right kind, the right company to look for. So after the ladies' time comes the Bible college, and then your own church. They are your own people. Don't seek guidance from the world. People who are themselves not being successful in their own careers will always think you're not good enough to do anything. But they do not know the power our God carries. He's a healer. He takes care, he has the power to change any professional little demands that you have. Our demands are too little, right? It's bigger than any battle that we fight. So one last line. I know I've gone ahead. Atul, one line last line. The conclusion is, no matter, you cannot govern anything, business, relationships, even a country, without God and the Bible. That's my learning of the last 25 years. Thank you. I welcome both of them to your Golden Grace Church.
From the end. Well, it is good to be back, and I was just thinking the worship team, what a beautiful blessing that is, isn't it? Beautiful blessing. And you know, in American football, they have different formations. And I notice, okay, that the worship team has a different formation. So you know, sometimes they're spread out, but I notice their new formation just standing ones in a line there. So really, really, it's amazing. So, Father, we thank you that we can really, really be here and enjoy your presence and fellowship with you. And this is such an awesome manifestation of grace that you've given us, the church. We ask you, Lord, that you would really bless this message, Lord, today. Have it to be everything that you want it to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, on Friday night, the Bible College of Pastor Karl's, we learned the principle of do not be a lone ranger. And Pastor Karl looked around the room. He says, does anybody remember that show? And I timidly raised my hand that I do remember when it came out in the 1950s. And but there is another show that came out at the same time. And that's called The Life of Riley. I don't know if Pastor John Kenny knows that, but he might understand the principle. But it was in the 1950s on American TV, The Life of Riley. It was about an average guy that went to work, lived an average life, but he always whistled. And at the close of the show, I remember, he was just like whistling down the lane. It's the life of Riley. Does anybody know what that expression means? Okay, it means a life of ease. And what made Mr. Riley have a life of ease? He was like, he was just like filled with joy, filled with relaxation. And I was going to say the question, does anybody whistle anymore? Anybody whistle in India? Are there any whistlers? Who whistles here? You know, there used to be an expression, whistle while you work. And, you know, just enjoy life. And there was a time that I bought this book a long time ago. My kids were young. And it was put out by not Bill Gaither, but Bill Gaither. And he put it out. It was an amazing book. It talked about all the animals, the principles of the animals. Anybody remember that book? Okay. Anyway, so we're learning something today. It was about all of the animals and their characteristics, and then he did the Bible principles with the animals. A great time. The kids loved it. You learned a lot about the word, a lot about animals. But I remember the one animal that stood out in my mind. It was the otter. I don't know how you say that in Hindi, but the otter is like a beaver, but smaller, swims in the water, rolls on his back, and the otter is very, very productive, but he has a fun time in everything he does. So what we want to talk about tonight is, this morning, the joy of the Lord. And in Psalm chapter 89, verse 15, it said, blessed is the people, blessed are happy, full of joy are the people that know the joyful sound. And I think we come in here today, we know the joyful sound. I mean, joy is so powerful. And they shall walk in the light of his countenance. So we want to just discuss three things. And we won't spend very much time on the enemy, but Satan, he really tries to destroy the joy. He cannot take our salvation. He cannot take our inheritance, but he does try to steal our joy. And then we want to look at the provision of joy. What as we're walking on this life, what do we take along? Like if you were a scout or you were a soldier, you take along a little bit of food, but you take your canteen of water. That's your provision you need. But the provision the believer really needs is the joy of the Lord. And then the third thing is, where does that joy come from? Well, Satan tries to destroy our, or not to destroy, but steal, rob our joy by the details of life. And yes, even Vodafone can steal your joy for a while. And if people know, I've had a little trouble with Vodafone. I know it's a fine company, but it's been used, okay, to try to steal my joy for a moment. My wife said, "Don't let it steal your joy." I said, "I won't, honey. Thank you for the encouragement." So we set our mind on the things above and not on Vodafone. If you work for Vodafone, fine company. I've had a little trouble. The second thing, okay, is worry. Don't let, okay, worry eat away. It's like a cancer to our joy. But we want what does joy do for the believer? And I said, you know, joy is everything for the believer. The joy of the Lord is our strength. I was talking to my wife this morning. She said, "What are you going to speak on?" I said, "Well, one verse is, eat the fat and drink the sweet." And she started laughing. So we have a good relationship. I said, "Yeah, you know, eat the fat and drink the sweet." Well, that's the A part of Nehemiah 8:10. We all know, okay, the joy of the Lord is our strength. But the A part, eat the fat, drink the sweet, and neither be sorry for anything. God wants us, okay, not to live in guilt, but to live in the joy of the Lord. And what is a joy? It's like everything. Joy gives us a dynamic that the world knows nothing about. Now, I'm not an engineer, but I understand the principle of the metric, like the metric, the mechanics, how it gets done, but the dynamics of joy the world knows nothing about. So we, speaking about fat, fat, like eat the fat, eat the joy of the Lord. The fat speaks about the anointing, the abundance, the fullness. Then my wife said, "Well, do you have an illustration to go along with that?" I said, "I sure do." She said, "You do?" I said, "Yes, I do." And but fat gives us high energy. When I was a young man, okay, we would have a beefsteak, and young kids, they don't like the fat around it. It gets crispy and things. If you're a vegetarian, I don't mean to be offensive. I think a veg diet is very, very healthy. But I don't have it. I wasn't raised that way. So that little fat gristle of my father, kids don't like it, but my father would say, I would give it to my dad. He said, "Yeah," and he would eat it, and he said, "That's high energy." It is high energy. It gives him energy. And I was thinking about the cake that Elijah ate. You know, that cake that he ate that kept him going for 40 days. That was the first high energy bar ever made, right? And another thing that fat does, fat gives really taste to things. You know, the healthy things are good. Maybe you live a year longer, but they don't taste as good, do they? Because they don't have fat in them. Fat gives taste to everything. And so the joy of the Lord. You know how when we're evangelizing, I'll tell you what, that little bit of joy, little bit of smile makes the gospel go down. And so praise the Lord. The third thing I just want to say is the source of joy. Where does joy come from? Well, we know it doesn't come from the world, but it's the joy of the Lord. So that's the direction. It's from above. And there is a joy in heaven over one sinner that repents. Joy. What the world does is happiness, but joy comes from above. Another place where the joy comes, it comes from the Holy Spirit and the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And then Psalm 46:4, there is a river, and the river speaks of the Holy Spirit, that the streams make glad the city of God. from the Holy Spirit, there's little tributaries or little streams, and that floods our life with joy. And then we get the joy, the word I found, and I did eat it, and it was a joy and a rejoicing over my heart. So thanks be to God that we can be here today, and we can fellowship in the joy. And then the closing, Proverbs 4:23 says, guard your heart with all diligence. Don't let things be stolen. Don't let the joy of the Lord be stolen with the details of life and all the trickery of the devil. Amen? God bless you.
So this morning,
I think that
the Holy Spirit spoke to me.
From now on,
I'm changing my diet.
It's the fat.
I need some sweet. I need both.
So
I'm not looking. It's really hard. I've really heard the Holy Spirit talking to me.
Breakfast of Champions Part 2. For the sake of those who missed last Sunday's message, let's review some of the main points of the message. Nothing in your walk as a believer is more important than the words of your confession. Do you remember what the people of Israel had done after they had seen God's powerful hand at the Red Sea? First, they praised the Lord for giving them a mighty deliverance from Pharaoh and his army. Second, they praised the Lord for his wonder-working power. Third, they praised the Lord because the inhabitants of Canaan would hear of his victories and they would fear the people of Israel. And fourth, they praised the Lord because God himself would bring them into the promised land. They had confessed, by your strength we will go in. By your guidance we will possess the land that you promised us. All the inhabitants of Canaan have heard of your fame and they are terrified. 8 times God was mentioned in their song of victory. After the Red Sea victory, who were the people of Israel conscious of? God. And what were they conscious of? God, his wonder-working power, his presence, his majesty, his strength. And what was their confession? God is able. God will do it. Our enemies and difficulties are nothing before us. They tremble before us and have melted away. God will lead us and plant us in the promised land. Now, fast forward to a scene just 12 months later. God has brought the same congregation of Israel to Kadesh Barnea, the southernmost border of the land of Canaan, which God had promised to give them. In Numbers 13, 1-2, the Lord gave Moses the commission to scout the land of Canaan, which he had promised to give them. After 40 days of scouting out the land and seeing that the land indeed was flowing with milk and honey, 10 of the scouts brought back a bad report, actually a report that stemmed from fear and unbelief. Thus the 10 spies, told Moses and said, "We went into the land where you sent us, and it certainly does flow with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. But the people who live in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. We are not able to go up against the people, for they are too strong for us." I want you to notice one serious omission from the report of the 10 spies. There is not one mention of God, His name, His power, His strength, His majesty, and His guidance. God is not occupying their vision. Since God is not occupying their vision, and since they are not conscious of God, therefore they magnify the difficulties they see by sight, resulting in their negative confession. When God is not occupying our vision, then no matter how many positive things we see, there will always be the but of unbelief. When we are not depending on God's wonder-working power and faithfulness to help us day by day, we enter into unbelief. Now our confession starts to become negative. We say, "Oh no, I'm single, I'll never get married." Or, "Oh no, I'm now married, but I wonder if my kids will follow after God when they are older." Or, "Oh no, the economy is not doing so good. I think I'll be the next one to lose my job." This reminds me of the story of the little boy who was chosen to play the part of Jesus in his school play. He was supposed to imagine himself as Jesus, walking on the water in the storm, coming to his disciples and saying, "It is I, do not be afraid." However, when he entered onto the stage and saw the audience, he panicked and got so flustered that he said, "It is me, and I am scared to death." Now let's see how Joshua and Caleb responded to the same situation. Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, of those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes, and they spoke to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, saying, "The land which we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, then He will bring us into the land and give it to us."
That's the attitude
we need to have.
We go into the land And do what God has told us to do.
Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they will be bread for us. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. Why was Joshua and Caleb's confession so filled with faith? It's because they were occupied and conscious of the Lord, His presence and His power. Therefore, their confession was, "We should by all means go up and take possession of the land, for we shall surely overcome." Three benefits of having a faith-filled confession. I want to share with you at least three major benefits of having a faith-filled confession. Firstly, our faith-filled confession helps us overcome the devil. I want you to learn a very important principle. Our confession can be very powerful. The words we speak go out into the atmosphere and are heard by those involved in the unseen spiritual warfare. Angels as well as Satan's demons. Satan and his demons cannot read our minds. However, because they have been studying the human race for the past 6,000 years, they have become quite efficient in deciphering what we are thinking by observing our countenances and listening to our confessions.
This is so important. You need to fully understand, because Satan cannot read my mind. God only can read my mind, but Satan cannot. However,
whenever
Satan watches me,
he knows from
my countenance
what I'm thinking.
Yes. Because he's been observing you and me for a long time.
So he knows
when you go through a difficult season, situation, at home.
As a spouse,
you get irritated.
And then Satan watches
your confession.
And then he projects
a thought
into
your mind
to ignite
your confession.
He gets you to say
something negative to your wife or husband.
And then
He watches for our reaction.
And accordingly, he plans the next thought.
We don't know, but we are using our vocal cords
To initiate.
To initiate.
What they want.
What he wants us
to initiate.
To initiate.
That is why the Bible says your tongue can be used
by hell.
James chapter 3, verse 6. So the next time
you open your mouth,
you need to know. Your confession.
Your confession
is very important.
It's very important.
When we face difficult situations, Satan and his demons wait for an opportunity to send their fiery darts of spiritual projections in order to get us to live in doubt, fear, unbelief, and despair. Their goal is to have us live in an attitude of defeat and have a negative confession.
So I do confess. You're faced with a difficult situation.
And maybe you are discouraged.
And you make a negative confession. So Satan wants to initiate. A series of projections
called fiery darts
into your mind.
Because he knows if you latch on to them, your thinking will go from discouragement to depression.
So never allow him to play a game with your mind.
You need to know that you will always confess the promise of God.
So that's what we need to do at home.
Every person who's having any kind of spiritual problem has talked himself into it. He confessed his way into the problem by reflecting the projections and initiations of the prince of the power of the air, Ephesians 2:2, instead of resisting them. Let me illustrate. Do you remember what happened in Job chapter 1? When God was speaking highly about his servant Job, Satan answered the Lord and said, Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge about him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But put forth your hand now and touch all that he has. He will surely curse you, God, to your face. Job 1:9-11.
If I can only attack Job, then I know he will curse God to his face.
So that's what I wanted.
That's what he wanted to do. However, I want to see what happened.
It's amazing.
Yes.
Because I never saw it before.
We know what happened. Even though Job did not sin with his lips, Satan got his wife to initiate a negative confession. Job 2 verse 9 records, then his wife said to Job, "Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die."
Pause. You see what she was saying?
The
very thing Satan wanted to say to Job.
So, of course, she was discouraged
because she lost 10 children.
She said the very thing that Satan wanted Job to do. Do you see how Satan wants?
He tries to use our vocal cords
to say what he wants to say.
Do you realize that Satan was using Job's wife's vocal cords to provoke him to do the very thing Satan wanted Job to do, curse God? It is important to realize that the death and life are in the power of the tongue, as we see in Proverbs 18:21. Every time we open our mouth to speak, we have a decision to make. Do we want to have a tongue which is set on fire by hell, James 3 verse 6, or a tongue which speaks words of life? The Word of God tells us how to overcome and negate the strategies of the devil. In Revelations 12:11 it says, "And the Christians overcame Satan because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony, and they did not love their life even to death." Here is how we overcome our enemy. Because of the blood of the Lamb, through the cross. Because of the word of our testimony, through our confession. And because we do not love our lives even to the death, through our commitment. When we learn to speak faith-filled and godly confessions, we give no place to the devil to play with our minds. Secondly, our faith-filled
confession.
From now on, I'm not going to give Satan a place to play with my mind.
So when he comes to me with his fiery darts, I'm going to say, it is written. Amen.
Secondly, our faith-filled confession gives us healthy emotions. Speaking the right things causes the emotions to rejoice. Solomon said in Proverbs 23 verse 16, "Yes, my emotions will rejoice when my lips speak right things." If I don't speak right things, then my emotions will reinforce my negative communication. Pastor Karl Stevens, in a message titled Power of Your Confession, said, many times as a believer, you have experienced situations that haven't felt good, yet your confession remained godly. Eventually, through the Holy Spirit, that confession becomes anointed, and you actually experience what you have been confessing in your heart without tangible evidence or emotional confirmations. Living by every word of God with a heart that dwells richly with Christ, the believer can say, I will confess what God says, and that is all I will confess. I will not confess defeat. I will not confess frustration. I will not confess depression. I will not confess that I do not have love. I will not confess a single negative thing. That is how we deal with our problems in a relationship, with our finances, with our weaknesses and our sicknesses. Our faith is in Jesus' promises. We need to confess God's provision continually. Confess God's power, His grace, and His love. If circumstances seem to say no, we simply confess, yes, God will come through. He will keep us during times of trouble. Out of our hearts will come the confession that Christ is real and what He has said will come to pass. Thirdly, our faithful confession is pleasing to God. Do you realize that our faithful confessions are pleasing to God? I want you to see what God said to Moses in Numbers 14, 22 to 25, after he heard the reports of the spies. Surely all the men who have seen my glory and my signs, which I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not listened to my voice, and shall by no means see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who spurned me see it. But my servant Caleb, because he has had a different spirit and has followed me fully, I will bring him into the land which he entered, and his descendants shall take possession of it.
Joshua and Caleb. And he says, Because
they have a different
spirit.
Therefore,
I'll bring them into the land. So God says the same thing
about us.
And that person, they have a different spirit.
Because they are following me.
They are following me.
Fully.
With faith. Through confession.
Why was God so pleased with Caleb and Joshua? It's because he had a different spirit of faith, evidenced by his faith confession. Hebrews 11 verse 6 tells us, "And without faith it is impossible to please God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him." Let's look at some other faith confessions of people in the Bible. Abraham, in Genesis 22 verse 5, Abraham said to his servants, "Settle down and stay here with the donkey. The young man and I will go over there and worship God, and we will come back to you." How could Abraham make such a faith confession to his servants that we will worship and come back, even though he knew God had asked him to offer up Isaac as a sacrifice? Hebrews 11, 17-19 tells us that it was because Abraham believed God's promise that in Isaac your descendants shall be called. It was because he considered that God is able to raise people even from the dead.
Abraham believed the promise that in Isaac your descendants will be blessed. That's the same way for us.
In Ruth chapter 1 verse 16, Ruth made a confession to Naomi when she said, "Do not urge me to leave you or to turn back from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God." Even though she was a young widow and a Gentile, Ruth knew that her hope and her future was with the living God and his hope. And his people. David, in 1 Samuel 17:45-46, David made a faith confession to Goliath when he said, "You come to me with a sword, a spear, and a javelin. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I will strike you down and cut off your head."
Think of this.
Saul.
The king.
It says he was.
Head on shoulders.
Head on shoulders.
Shoulder above.
Head and shoulder above.
Other
Israelites.
He would not directly take on Goliath.
Why?
Because
he was looking
at the size
of the giant. He said
to David,
You want to go?
Oh, go.
May the Lord be with you.
He said, take my armor.
Yes. Because
I'm not going to do this.
Anyways.
So why was David?
So filled with faith.
Yes, David was an expert with the slingshot, but that was not the reason for his confidence. David was confident of his victory beforehand because he knew that Israel had a covenant with the living God. Daniel's friends in Daniel 3 verse 16 to 18, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego made a faith confession before King Nebuchadnezzar. O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to answer you on this point. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to rescue us from the furnace of blazing fire, and he will rescue us from your hand, O King. But even if he does not, let it be known to you, O King, that we are not going to serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up.
I want you to remember this confession.
We made by all these people
in the midst of a trial.
Many people say, I believe God for this, however. Because they never learn the power of confession.
Of confessing the promises.
Therefore, all the promises.
I never use at the time that they need the most.
It's no use knowing the Bible if you don't believe it.
And then speak them out.
Amen.
What Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were saying was, we trust in God alone. Just as we did at salvation, we trust in Christ by faith. Therefore, if you take us up to slay us because of our faith in Christ, we will not alter our confession. If we die because of our confession, we will go home to be with God and be blessed. By the way, God responded to each of these people in a marvelous way. Abraham returned from Mount Moriah with his arm around the shoulder of his son Isaac, overjoyed that he had passed God's test. Ruth married a Jewish man called Boaz and eventually became the great-grandmother of King David. David's stone found its mark and he earned the reputation of being a giant killer. David's three friends found out that God was able to deliver them and that even in the furnace of fire, Christ was walking with them. You see, our faith pleases God, and He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him.
Pause. So if you went to David's home, you'd see a big wall in the living room. In David's room
was the head
of a lion.
Of a bear.
Of a bear.
And Goliath.
And Goliath.
It says
he took the head of Goliath
back to
Jerusalem,
and he put the sword
in his weapons
of treasury. Imagine every time
he looked at the sword,
he was reminded of what he did,
but what God did.
Because God is our champion.
The breakfast of champions. Now here are some final closing thoughts, which led me to give this message its name. When we were young, my parents used to make sure we had a daily serving of Champion Oats. On the cover of the box was written these words, "The Breakfast of Champions." When we face seemingly giant-sized difficulties that God places in our paths, we need to remember what Joshua said in Numbers 14, verse 9. "The Lord is for us. Do not be afraid of those giants. We shall overcome them. They will be bread for us." In other words, Joshua was saying, we will have those giants for breakfast. Now, what happens when you have a good breakfast? You get energized and become stronger. Well, that's what happens in our spiritual lives too. God our Father places seeming giants in our life and says, look to me. Together we will have this giant grasshopper for breakfast. By the way, the bigger the giants, the better the breakfast, the stronger the champion. Let's possess what God has promised. The nation of Israel did not enter into the promised land at the time of Moses. They failed to possess what God had promised them. We too as believers can forfeit possessing what God has planned for us because of fear, doubt, and unbelief.
If you focus on God, the giants become like grasshoppers.
If we want to do anything for the kingdom, we need to know God.
When we were building a school, an orphanage, we faced many issues, financial issues. However, today we can say we overcame.
We are stronger.
It's the same way with missions.
In our strength,
we can never
take on
what God calls us.
We're not called to live in our strength.
God says, focus on me.
I'm giving you.
These giants for breakfast. It's the same
with our marriage. We need to go on and possess.
We need to go on and possess
the land.
Because
God
has
wants you to have a wonderful marriage.
40 years later, when God was preparing the nation to enter into the land, He gave to Joshua, the new leader, a promise and a command. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, and you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, the children of Israel. Now here's the promise. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses. The size of their inheritance depended on how much land they stood on, walked on, and really claimed. And here's the command. Only be strong and very courageous. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Joshua 1, 7 and 8. I believe that God told them to meditate on His word day and night so that they would become strong and courageous, because as they meditated, they would become conscious of God's power and presence instead of the size of the giants.
So this morning we heard the same thing from Dipti. Remember, she had some giants in her pathway. She had depression. However, as she meditated on God's word.
God began to prosper, and her wisdom, and she began to prosper, because that's what the solution is for
every day of our lives.
It's meditation on God and His Word.
By the way, when the nation of Israel finally entered the Promised Land, they found out that the fear of the Lord had already taken over the inhabitants of the land. Do you remember what Rahab said to the two spies sent by Joshua into the city of Jericho? I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land have melted away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed.
This is amazing. If you think about it, 40 years later, there's a woman called Rahab in Jericho, and she says, we heard you guys were coming, because we were trembling, because we heard God gave you the land.
And she said, we heard what God did in the Red Sea.
So there was That was 40 years
before.
She still remembered what God did
at
the Red Sea.
And now she says,
we also heard about
your recent victories.
Therefore,
everyone
in the city
is scared
of you.
So remember,
the Israelites said the inhabitants will fear us and melt away.
When we heard it, our hearts melted, and no courage remained in any man any longer because of you. For the Lord your God, He is God in heaven above and on earth beneath. Joshua 2, 8-11. The inhabitants of Jericho had already heard about God's presence and power, and they were afraid of His conquest. In fact, the nation of Israel did not actually have to fight. They only had to march around the walls and shout.
Praise God. Turn to your neighbor and say, the enemy needs to fear us.
So because we have a covenant with God.
Amen.
Remember, often God does not put victory in our hands. Instead, He gives us the resources for victory: His Holy Spirit, His Word, and His finished work, and puts victory within our reach so that we will take up our victory by faith.
That's a powerful statement.
Yes, God told Abraham to go over land by faith.
He told Noah to go into all the areas by faith.
So God gives us all we need for the victory. However, we need to go forward and take the victory by faith, whatever it is in your life.
Don't just stand there and wait for God.
Say, Lord, because God told Moses.
Why are you crying out to me?
Go forward and stand still and you will see my salvation.
Did you know that the first step that God used to move David to be king was to place a giant in his path? It was only after David slew the giant that he was recognized as a potential champion and leader. I believe that when God places seeming giants in your path, it's because He wants you to become a faith champion, and because He has prepared a larger vision and a God-designed destiny for your life. Remember, the bigger the giants, the better the breakfast, the stronger the champion, and the greater your God-sized destiny.
Amen. So remember.
It was
as the nation
of Israel,
was going forward
and the will of God,
in the will of God.
And met the giants.
They met the giants.
If they turned back,
there would have been no giants.
When we face giants,
we often think maybe this is not God's will.
It's not true.
Because
in the will of God,
He places some giants for us to conquer,
so we can be people of faith. So in your journey forward,
remember, you will face some giants in your family,
financial giants,
maybe some issues with your children. However, you say to your spouse,
we will have this for breakfast. Plan now, never to confess negative.
Because as soon as you do, the enemy wants to make it worse.
So remember your faithful confessions.
They bless your emotions.
And they praise God.
Because God commands.
Because God can work best.
God can work best
when there is an atmosphere of believing. So for this month, you say to your spouse,
the bigger the giants, the bigger the breakfast, and the bigger we are going to be faith champions. We're going to be faith champions.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for really being able to be here and to hear these words. We thank you, Father, that you have spoken this today. Lord, these words are so encouraging and they're so real. They have such a firm foundation and an excellent track record. We ask you, Lord Jesus, that you would just really use these words in each one of our hearts, that you will send us forth not fearful of the giants, but looking forward to the big breakfast. In Jesus' name,
amen.